please unmute the mic and begin. So with that housekeeping in order, I want to say good morning again to everyone. And I am really honored to be joined by county leaders, you know, from Palo Alto to Gilroy today to join us as we announce the enhanced health orders to make sure that all of our partners are providing the testing that's going to be needed to help our community gain its health and resilience. The more people we all know who can easily get tested for COVID-19 by their healthcare providers, the better chance we have of staying in the red and improving the health of our entire community. What this really means is we get children back to school and people back to work. So with that, I'm gonna begin right away by introducing Dr. Sarah Cody, Santa Clara County's public health officer, and she will explain the enhanced testing order. You're on mute, Sarah. All right, we're gonna see if someone can. Dr. Cody, we still can't hear you. All right, you want to try?
All right. Can you hear me now, Supervisor?
Yes, we can.
Wonderful. Okay. And we're going to turn off. Wonderful. All right. Good morning. Thank you so much. As James Williams, our county council, will explain in greater detail, today I am issuing a revised testing order to ensure better access to COVID-19 testing for everyone who lives in our county. And please remember, testing is incredibly important to our collective ability to contain COVID. And as we all know, embers start fires, and people with COVID, especially those who don't know that they have it, start COVID outbreaks. So testing is really foundational to our ability to prevent COVID. So as we try to increase our access for everyone to COVID testing, our county will continue to support our local healthcare providers, insurers, hospitals, health centers, and clinics as they build their COVID testing capacity. Increased capacity will help protect our entire community and ensure that everyone, from teachers to frontline healthcare workers, has access to readily available, barrier-free, free of cost COVID testing. We, the county, have invested substantially in making free COVID tests available, and we welcome any partners who can help expand our local capacity further. As our local school districts take steps towards reopening their schools for in-person learning, there's going to be an even greater need to make tests available so we can keep our teachers, our school staff, and our kids safe. We are all in this together, and we hope everyone will do their part to help keep our communities safe. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Cody. I'm now going to ask James Williams, our county council, to speak.
Good morning. I'm James Williams, county council. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Great. As Dr. Cody described, testing is the first most critical step towards tackling COVID-19 as a community. That's why on June 10th, the county health officer issued an order requiring large healthcare systems to, at a minimum, provide access to testing to several important categories of county residents, including essential workers and those who have come into contact with people who are COVID-19 positive. The June order was among the first of its kind in the state, and today, the county health officer has issued an updated order that makes several important enhancements to the June order. These enhancements are all aimed towards ensuring that our community's large healthcare systems make COVID-19 testing easy, accessible, and timely. First, the enhanced order expands the definition of essential worker and aligns it with the state's regulation that mandates that insurers cover COVID-19 testing for those same essential workers. Essential workers include teachers, school staff, grocery store clerks, first responders, healthcare workers, and many more. Second, too many people still don't know they can and have the right to be able to get tested through their healthcare provider. So the enhanced order requires that healthcare systems prominently inform patients of their right to testing under the order. They must post the notice in all patient care areas and also on their websites and in their communications. Third, the enhanced order sets mandatory timelines so patients get tested quickly and get their results sooner too. We know COVID testing must be timely to be effective. Fourth, the enhanced order makes clear that practices that would inhibit, discourage, or delay access to testing are prohibited. We have seen and heard about concerning practices by healthcare providers that discourage COVID-19 testing or make it hard to access. That must end. The testing order is mandatory. It establishes our minimum expectations for these healthcare systems. They can and should do more. But if healthcare systems do not meet these minimum standards, they are subject to fines and can face other sanctions. Anyone who believes there's a violation of the order should let us know at our online portal, scccovidconcerns.org. We know these requirements are 100% achievable. In fact, the county's own health and hospital system is already meeting these expectations and exceeding them. That means there's no excuse. And this order is in place to help ensure our broader healthcare system is doing its part to keep our community safe and to help us move forward together. Thank you.
Thank you, James, and thanks for all of the work that you and Dr. Cody are doing. I now get the honor of introducing my colleague, Supervisor Joe Simidian.
There we go. Thank you so much, Supervisor Chavez. And let me just say right off the bat, we can't make smart countywide decisions if we don't test. We can't put people back to work if we don't test. We can't keep people healthy and well if we don't test. And as was referenced earlier, we can't send kids back to school if we don't test. Testing is the key to moving forward. We have known that for a very long time. I see Mayor Liccardo on the call with us today, and I remember our board meeting at March the 10th when both he and I expressed the deep concern about the need and importance of testing. It has been 6 months. It has been 3 months since the public health officer issued her order calling on large healthcare systems to step up and do their fair share in terms of providing testing. The citizenry, the public, has made great sacrifices and been very patient, quite frankly. 6 months later, after this issue was first raised, 3 months later, after a public health order, there really is no excuse for large healthcare systems not to have stepped up and done their fair share, complied with the public health order. They will tell us that it's hard. That's true. They'll tell us there have been supply chain problems. Also true. And here's what I would say. Those are the same challenges that the county has had to meet and master in order to up its testing regimen. So if it's hard, if there are supply chain problems, then step up. And as one of our doctors often says, if there's a need for greater capacity, then build it, buy it, or pool your tests. I'll say it again, build it, buy it, or pool your tests. Kaiser Healthcare System is the largest managed care organization in the country. They have something like 600,000 lives for which they are responsible in Santa Clara County. My expectation is that they will step up and comply with the public health order. Sutter Health and Palo Alto Medical Foundation. Sutter here in Northern California alone has 24 hospitals and 200 clinics. I expect them to step up and comply with the public health order. As we go forward, the only way we're going to keep ourselves safe, get back to work, let a grandparent hug their grandkids safely, is by getting the testing done. And that means now, not later, not weeks or months from now, but today. Thank you very much. And I appreciate all the mayors being here today to share their concern that this is a countywide issue.
Thank you very much, Supervisor Simidian. And I want to acknowledge that For months now, every Saturday, all of the mayors have been meeting with supervisors, Semidian and myself and our staff, to better coordinate all of our efforts. And one of the top issues that we've been discussing have been testing. And I really want to thank and acknowledge all of the leadership that we've had from our mayors. And I want to begin by introducing Mayor Sam Liccardo.
Thank you, President Chavez. Thank you for your leadership, to Supervisor Semidian for his leadership, for the great work of James Williams and Dr. Siricotti. We are grateful that the county has announced an order that is going to demolish the labyrinth that too many of our residents have found themselves when they are trying to find their way to get to testing, by ensuring that there will be insurance coverage for more of our residents, ensuring that the testing will be more readily available by their healthcare providers, and by ensuring that each one of us has a path that doesn't simply demand more of our strapped county resources. The county has clearly stepped up to provide more testing countywide. I am grateful to see that. There's been tremendous work now under Dr. Marty Fenstersheib and all the efforts to get more facilities out there. But the only way we're really going to be able to beat this virus is by having all of our healthcare providers pushing with us. And I think it's important to emphasize this is certainly about lives, but it's also about livelihoods. We know that the state order for reopening and various activities, including a lot of jobs that we critically need to get back in our community, really depends on our ability to test. In fact, explicitly in the state formula, testing is a criterion that will enable us to be able to move from purple to red to other colors in the future. So I just want to say thank you to the leadership of all the folks at the county, and thank you to all of my colleagues, mayors throughout the region, for your strong support of this effort.
Thank you, Mayor Liccardo, and thank you for all of the work that you've been doing on behalf of all of us to make sure that the county is fed while we go through this process. I'd like now to introduce Mayor of Sunnyvale, Larry Klein.
Thank you, and I want to thank President Chavez, the Board of Supervisors, and Santa Clara County Health Department for partnering with our cities on testing and tracing and looking for a best way forward during these difficult times. I want to especially thank the Santa Clara County Department of Health for, you know, stepping up and bearing the brunt of the COVID-19 testing load for the last 6 months, and for bringing pop-up testing into all of our communities. You know, however, the county has had to step up because some of the large healthcare providers haven't been carrying their load. And as for those healthcare providers, you know, I've been really disappointed with several of their capricious decisions or policies, which, whether it's, you know, the multiple hoops that they made our residents jump through for before approving testing, or just flat out turning down testing requests. You know, I was at Sunnyvale pop-up testing site on Monday and actually met a healthcare worker from one of those healthcare providers who couldn't get tested as often as she wanted at her hospital and ultimately came to the county to get tested more frequently. You know, adequate testing is critical to moving us back to a new normal, whatever that new normal might be. It's important that our residents, and more importantly, our essential workers, our teachers, our healthcare workers, our grocery store workers and restaurant workers need to get tested. You know, I'm happy to be here today with the other elected officials to call upon our large healthcare providers to just comply with the June 10th County Health Order, and of course the new order, and make COVID-19 testing readily available to everyone. You know, it's critical that for everyone's health and safety at the end of the day, and it just needs to get done. Thank you.
Thank you for your leadership, Mayor Klein. The next mayor I'd like to introduce is the mayor of Saratoga, Mayor Howard Miller.
Thank you, Cindy. You know, everybody's gonna talk about the same issue. And I just want to get very real here. Kaiser is my hospital. Kaiser covers 40% of the residents of Santa Clara County. Kaiser Northern California covers 4.5 million people in Northern California. But Kaiser is doing an exceptionally small percentage of the testing. They need to carry their fair share. And I checked just today on the Kaiser website, It is impossible to schedule a test in the Kaiser website. They put all the questions there, but you land at a spot where it says, oh, you didn't check some box. And I may not be the smartest computer user with a master's degree in computer science from Stanford and 20 patents. And I maybe made a mistake on Kaiser's website, but I tried three different platforms, four different browsers, and you get the same result. A real citizen cannot schedule a test at Kaiser without making a phone call. When you make that phone call, you will find out you have to talk to five different people before they will authorize a test. And then when they do authorize a test, you'll find out that it's 3 days from now. And when you take that test, you will find out the results are going to take 3 to 4 days to come back. This is not in the interest of public health in the county. And I think that Kaiser owes it to their members to provide timely and available testing, not just for somebody who's going to have surgery in a Kaiser facility, but to all of their members. We have grocery store workers who put their lives on the line every day. We have first responders put their lives on the lines every day. We have transit workers who are transporting people every day, and they need to know if there's any concern. They need to know if they've been affected, and they need to be able to do that quickly and efficiently. And while Kaiser may have the words on their website, the way they're implementing it and their policies are not matching what is needed for public health. So I'm calling on Kaiser and on all of the health providers in the county. Let's step it up. We're only going to get through this together, and everybody needs to do their fair share. Thank you, Cindy.
Thank you very much, Howard, and thank you for all the input you've given us as well. I now get an opportunity to introduce the mayor of Gilroy, Roland Velasco.
So thank you so much, Cindy. First off, let me just say that this morning I was at a virtual Chamber of Commerce breakfast meeting, and I mentioned that we were going to be having this press conference today with the elected officials of the county, Board of Supervisors, the mayors throughout the county, and of course, the staff members of the county. And it was interesting because I immediately got feedback about how difficult it was to get tested by the private hospitals, in particular Kaiser. Words used were frustrating, discouraging, and a process that was burdensome. One person mentioned that a Kaiser nurse told her to go to a county testing site for an easier and faster process. I have to say, as a Kaiser member for nearly 50 years, it was incredibly disturbing to hear such comments. I would encourage all private hospitals to increase their diagnostic testing for the benefit of their members and for the public health of all residents in the county. We know that additional testing and early detection will be critical to ensuring that the county remains in the red tier so that we can open up our businesses, open up our schools, and open up our faith community. So again, I would encourage all hospitals, all private hospitals, to increase their diagnostic testing. Thank you so much, Cindy.
Thank you for joining us, Mayor. I now get the opportunity to introduce the Mayor of Mountain View, Margaret Abe-Koga.
Good morning, and thank you to President Chavez, County Supervisor Simidian, and the Santa Clara County Public Health Department for your leadership and for bringing us all together this morning. Early on, when shelter in place took effect, we here in North County were hearing the same challenges of not being able to get testing, and we didn't have any test sites in the North County area. So our mayors banded together, and thank you to the many mayors on this morning, contacted the county Public Health Department and President Chavez. And fortunately, thanks to their leadership, we were able to get a test site in Mountain View Since then, we've been able to also partner with Planned Parenthood and El Camino Health to provide testing sites. So far we've had about 6,000 tests, but frankly, as everyone has mentioned, that's not enough. In order for us to be able to reopen and get our businesses back up and running, we need more testing, and we need all our healthcare providers to provide easy access to our residents. And so I join with all of the other mayors and the county this morning, asking that everyone, all healthcare providers, follow the new order, and be able to provide all of our residents throughout the county free or accessible testing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Avi Kogan. Thank you for your early encouragement, getting us working together more closely. Thank you. I now want to introduce Morgan Hill Mayor Rich Constantine. You're on mute, Rich.
Sorry about that. Thank you, President Chavez. Constantine is spelled C-O-N-S-T-A-N-T-I-N-E. And as mentioned, I'm the mayor of Morgan Hill. I want to echo my colleagues' remarks when I want to thank the county for their leadership in testing. I know I'm not going to be reiterative when I talk about the lack of testing in my healthcare provider. I too am a Kaiser patient and have not been able to get tested with Kaiser. I had to get tested, my daughter and I had to get tested from the county. As you've heard, it's vitally important that we test. The only reason why the county has moved from the purple tier to the red tier is because of testing. So it's vitally important that we band together. The system only works if we work together, and testing is really the only thing that's gonna prevent us from is going to be the only thing that's going to prevent us from opening up the county. We need to know who is who has COVID-19 so that we can prevent it, we can isolate it. And again, the only way we're going to be able to do that is if we test. So you're going to hear a lot of stories about health systems not stepping up, but we're here today to ask all health systems, again, to work together, test, test, test. Thank you very much, President Chavez.
Thank you very much, Mayor. I now get an opportunity to introduce the Mayor of Palo Alto, Adrian Fine.
Thank you, President Chavez, and thanks to all my fellow mayors for joining this. Palo Alto is blessed with three world-class hospitals, and they have been a great help in testing essential workers like our firefighters and utility workers. But I have heard far too many stories from my community that tests are hard to find, hard to get, and take too long for useful results. That's not acceptable. In order for our community to reopen, to get businesses, schools, and the economy going again, we need our healthcare providers to be partners in offering comprehensive testing for anyone who wants a test. Every time the county and my city have partnered to offer free pop-up testing, the socially distanced line has been around the block. The demand is there. And whether you want to send your kids back to school, visit an aging parent, or if your job requires you to come into contact with others, comprehensive testing is the cornerstone. I look forward to working with our healthcare providers to increase public testing capacity across Santa Clara County. And I want to thank our county supervisors and the Santa Clara County Public Health Department for leading this effort. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Fine. I am really honored to get to introduce Monte Serino Mayor Liz Lawler.
Thank you, Supervisor Chavez, and thank you to the entire Board of Supervisors for leading this effort. I'm here this morning to support the county's efforts to expand COVID-19 testing. Based on the new state metrics for reopening, we all know the key component to our success is more testing. Our children are the collateral damage in the COVID-19 shutdowns. Our children need to be in school with their classmates and teachers, not only for their education, but for their emotional well-being. For many children, school is the safest place for them to be. To our private healthcare systems, I urge you to comply with the revised order issued by Dr. Sarah Cody today and expand your testing so that our most precious resource, our children, can be back in the classroom where they belong. If for nothing else, do it for our children. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Lawler. I'm pleased to introduce also Los Altos Mayor Jan Pepper.
Thank you, President Chavez. And I want to say thank you to the county for the leadership that you've shown during these difficult times. And I echo all of my fellow mayor's comments. If we're going to get COVID reduced in our county, we need to get everyone tested and get those results back quickly. And especially as we have our children going back to school for some limited in-person learning, testing is critical to keep those children, teachers, school administrators, and their parents, siblings, and grandparents safe. I do want to recognize the announcement today that the El Camino Hospital District is stepping up to offer free pop-up testing in Los Altos next week. And I hope all healthcare providers step up to keep all of us healthy and safe by providing easy access to testing and rapid results. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayor. Our last mayor today is Mayor Rich Tran. And thank you, Mayor, for joining us. He is the mayor of Milpitas.
Thank you so much, President Chavez, and thank you to the Supervisor Semidian, the Department of Public Health at Santa Clara County, Dr. Sarah Cody. Thank you all for being leaders in our nation to ensure that we mitigate the pandemic and COVID-19. And I wish other counties across our nation would follow your lead. Here in Milpitas, I think we're the only city in the county that provides mobile testing. We, over the last couple of years, purchased our own ambulance, which is operated under our fire department. And my good city council has really led the effort to ensure that we're doing mobile testing with our ambulance in different neighborhoods across our city 5 days a week. And the only requirement is for folks to show up, whether they're a Milpitas resident or not, whether they have medical insurance or not. However, there's one issue that has really risen throughout the last several weeks and months we've been providing this service. If a person has Kaiser, we can't provide a COVID test for them. We direct those folks to contact Kaiser. And it becomes a huge barrier for these residents and community members. They're unable to get tested. They go through the same process that I actually go through as a Kaiser patient to go to their Kaiser website and fill out some answers to some questions. And it's really been a really negative thing for a lot of our community members not to have the ability to get tested. And I'll use myself as an example. I go out and serve our community a lot. I do food distributions with the partnership of Second Harvest Food Bank at our Milpitas High School, and I'm out in the community, and I still have not been able to get tested. I've gone to the Kaiser website, and I've filled out, to the best of my knowledge, answers to the questions they provide, and I have not been able to get tested. And so there are quite a number of folks in our town that want to get tested. Here at the city of Milpitas, we've tested over 3,000 persons with, I think, about a 4% positivity rate. And we could test so many more people. And so today, I stand with the mayors and our board of supervisors and Dr. Sarah Cody to really let Kaiser know, hey, we're right here and we want to get tested. We're your patients. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayor Tran. Thank you for the leadership that your city's played in testing your community. I now, to wrap this up, I'm gonna turn it over to David Campos, former Supervisor Campos of San Francisco, but David Campos to make a statement in Spanish, and then we'll go to Q&A from the press. Thank you.
Thank you very much, President Chavez, Supervisor Semidian, Dr. Cody, Mr. Williams, Honorable Mayors. I'm going to proceed to provide some just a brief summary of what happened in Spanish. Buenos días, mi nombre es David Campos, soy ejecutivo adjunto del condado de Santa Clara. Y en esta reunión de prensa hemos oído de primeramente de la presidenta de la mesa de supervisores, la presidenta Cindy Chavez, el supervisor Joseph Midian y alcaldes de las diferentes ciudades del condado y la oficial de salud pública, la doctora Sarah Cody. Lo que se ha hecho hoy es se ha presentado una nueva orden de pruebas de COVID-19 Esta orden aumenta los requerimientos a las diferentes organizaciones privadas, los hospitales grandes privados, que bajo la orden que fue presentada el 10 de junio, tienen el requerimiento de proveer pruebas de COVID-19 a sus pacientes. Bajo estos cambios en la nueva orden, los requerimientos son más estrictos para proveer más acceso a cada paciente de esos hospitales. Específicamente, le recordamos a miembros del público que pueden recibir una prueba del COVID-19 si su hospital les provee salud pública, si usted tiene los siguientes síntomas. Usted está bajo las siguientes categorías. Primeramente, si tiene síntomas del COVID-19. Segundamente, si ha sido expuesto a alguien que fue infectado con el COVID-19. Y si usted ha sido referido a que reciba una prueba de COVID-19 por su médico. Y finalmente, si es parte de lo que se llama trabajador esencial bajo la ley de California. Y eso es muy importante porque sabemos que hay muchas personas que están trabajando en trabajos esenciales que son miembros de estos hospitales privados que no están recibiendo las pruebas. Finalmente, les indicamos que hay una página web que se llama sccovidconcerns.org, donde puedes reportar violación de esta orden de ley. Finalmente, la razón por la cual se le pide a estos hospitales que provean estas pruebas de COVID-19 es porque aunque estos hospitales representan a la mayoría de la población, la gran mayoría de pruebas de COVID-19 son hechas no por esos hospitales, sino que por el condado. Muchas gracias.
David, thank you so much. We're now going to ask for members of the press to speak. This, and what we'll do is I'm going to ask staff both to call your name and then they will unmute you and we'll get questions to the right party for you. So Alex, do you want to take it away?
Yes, thank you, Supervisor. We have Fiona Kelleher from Mercury News on the line. I'll be sending you an unmute now. Please accept the unmute to present your question.
Hey, thanks so much for taking my question. This is probably for James, but I'm just wondering, I'm looking at the order now and I'm not seeing too much information on the fines that you've mentioned. Could you walk me through what exactly those would be? And practically speaking, you know, you would hear a complaint about a provider, for example, and then how a fine might be put in place after that. So the enforcement mechanism, in other words.
Thank you, James.
Absolutely, I'd be happy to speak to that. So the enforcement mechanism actually is incorporated as part of the underlying urgency ordinance that the board adopted in early August, which creates a framework for civil enforcement for all health orders, including the testing order. So this fits within that same framework, and so it's the same fine structure and administrative process. So that's kind of that one piece of it. But you know, the reason we've got a portal set up and really want to encourage folks who have concerns, and we've heard several examples from the mayors, and we've heard many, many other examples, obviously, directly. But we really want to encourage those who are encountering challenges to let us know if you're being denied a test and you have a right to get a test under the order. Go to sccovidconcerns.org and fill out the information there that gives us the tools and information that we need in order to ensure that we can hold these large healthcare systems accountable for compliance with this mandate.
Thank you, Alex.
Yes, we have Henrietta Burrows from East Palo Alto today on the line. Henrietta, I'll be sending you an unmute now. Please accept the unmute to present your question.
Yes, thank you very much. This is a question possibly for Dr. Cody. A few weeks ago, the CDC, it was reported, issued some new guidelines telling people who were asymptomatic that they didn't need to be tested. So since testing is now more widely available, who should get tested?
Thank you so much for your question. And thank you for highlighting the importance of testing people who don't have symptoms. We know that approximately 40% of people with COVID may not have any symptoms at all. And that's precisely why making testing easily accessible and widely available is so important. Because if you don't know that you have COVID, you can't take measures to protect people living in your household or your coworkers or anyone else. So as everyone has highlighted, testing is really the key to keeping the community safe. And it's the key to driving down rates, because without a test, you don't know your status and you can't break a chain of transmission. So it's really foundational to community-wide safety and foundational to being able to reopen more and get people back to work and back to school. And so unfortunately, we don't like to do, I don't like to do things by health orders, but I think that the health order makes it really clear who needs to be tested and why.
Just to follow up on that, how often? Because the tests indicate one specific period of time. And even though someone might test negative, that doesn't mean next week they may not contract the virus. So how often should people get tested?
So the question is, how often?
Dr. Cody, you just muted yourself. Go ahead.
The question is, how often should people get tested? And the answer really depends on how frequently someone is exposed. So for example, someone who is like an essential worker who's having daily exposure to members of the public may not be able to socially distance, they're gonna need to be tested much more frequently than someone who's not. Certainly anyone who knows that they were in contact with someone who had COVID, they absolutely need to get tested, and they may need to get tested more than once. But this all highlights how incredibly important it is to make testing widely available and easily accessible. This should not be a barrier. Testing should not be a barrier. People need to know their status and whether they're infectious.
Thank you.
Alex?
Thank you. We have Len Ramirez from KPIX on the line. Len, I'll be sending you an unmute now. Please accept the unmute to present your question.
Hi there, and thank you for taking the question. I'm not sure exactly who would be the person to answer this, but can you give us an idea of how many tests, since Kaiser has been mentioned several times, how many tests Kaiser is doing currently, either daily, weekly, how many should they be doing? And then by comparison, how many is the county doing? And then as a follow-up to that, if we can have numbers in terms of dollar amounts on what the fines could be to prompt more action.
I'm gonna turn that question, if I can, to both Dr. Cody and to James, whichever has the most information.
I will start out. One is, I believe some of the detail that you're looking for is in the press release, which I don't have in front of me at the moment. But I also would like to point you to the website. There is a dashboard that's specific to healthcare systems, so you can see how each healthcare system is doing and how they compare. And that's updated regularly. So that's actually the best source for up-to-date information. And as far as your enforcement question, I'm gonna turn that over to James Williams.
I have the number.
On our dashboard, it lists COVID-19 tests by healthcare system in the last week. And so looking at that data right now, and you can find it on the county's COVID-19 site, it lists the total number of tests, average daily number of tests, the average daily rate based on patients served. And so if you look, for example, at the County of Santa Clara Health System, The current number is about 1867 daily tests being conducted by the county, which is an average daily rate of 622 tests for patients served. The numbers for Kaiser, by contrast, the average, the daily average number of tests is 609 and the rate 102. And there's a little graph that kind of shows a stark contrast there as well. And I think David Campos has some more to add as well.
If I may, just to point to the press release where we provided the numbers for the week of August 31st through September 6th, the County of Santa Clara Health System conducted 13,072 tests, and Kaiser conducted 4,261 tests.
And the fines?
James, could I ask you to respond to that?
And I'm sorry, I missed the question.
James, what Len was asking about is what's the fine structure?
Oh, sure. So the fine structure is based on the same structure as in the urgency ordinance. And so that structure allows the county to potentially levy fines of up to $5,000 per violation, and this order makes clear, each and every instance, for example, someone being denied a test who is entitled to a test, or a violation of the noticing provisions, or a violation of any of the other provisions in the order, including impediments to access, is potentially the subject of a separate independent fine. And so as you can imagine, potentially those could significantly add up if there's a substantial noncompliance, widespread noncompliance, and those fines can accrue daily. So, our expectation is that there will be a real meaningful, full, complete commitment to compliance. But we are absolutely already looking at many of the concerns that have been expressed about what's been happening under the current testing order, which, as was mentioned, has been in place since June 10th. Now with the enhanced order, making many of those requirements more explicit and phrased in a way that was always the expectation on healthcare systems, but unfortunately hasn't been the case. We haven't seen some of these things implemented, so now they're called out in a very explicit manner, and we will be holding people accountable to each of those items.
If I could get one more in, how will that be enforced, James?
So we have our health order enforcement team that includes folks from the county council's office, my office, as well as enforcement officers, primarily from our Department of Environmental Health. We have a complaint portal, scccovidconcerns.org. We will be investigating complaints that come in, following up as needed, using that documentation and our own independent investigation to then proceed with the appropriate enforcement action.
Thank you.
Alex?
Thank you, Lynn. And now we have Kat Ho from SF Chronicle on the line. Kat, I'll be sending you an unmute now. Please accept the unmute to present your question.
Kat, did you have a question? Kat, do you want to try again? We are not able to hear Kat. Could we go to the next person and try Kat again?
Okay. We have Jody Meacham from the Silicon Valley Business Journal on the line. Jody, I'll be sending you an unmute now. Please accept the unmute to present your question.
Thanks. This may be for Dr. Cody. Can the county quantify how far behind we are in testing due to the lack of private healthcare systems participation that's been described this morning? numbers like tests done versus the tests needed? For example, would Santa Clara County be in a less restrictive state tier if these tests had been provided earlier?
Thank you for the question. The state has, it's really a sliding scale. So the more testing that you do, the more of a discount that you get. So we have our case rate, how many cases do we have per day? It's a 7-day rolling average. And then we get a discount based on our testing rate. And it's a gradient. I can't tell you off the top of my head, but we will follow up with you to let you know the range. We have not gotten the full discount that we might be able to if we were doing more testing. I do want to go back and underline really the why. Why is this so important? And we just cannot say this enough. It's because of the very high proportion of people who have no symptoms at all. And if they don't have a test, they don't know that they're putting others at risk. And so if we don't have widely available access to testing and rapid results, we can't break those chains of transmission. And I think, you know, the experience in Maine with the wedding, where one gathering has led to so many infections and so many deaths, quite distant from the original event, really underscores how important it is to test and know your status and then be able to rapidly isolate and protect others. And that's really the top line message. And the state recognizes how important that is, so they've incentivized it and they discount our testing rate, which is fantastic because it will allow us to open more faster, which we badly want to do.
So as a follow-up, can you say that because we have lacked this cooperation from private healthcare systems, that we have not reopened?
I just wanted to say again, let us get back to you with the numbers of the range, and we can tell you how far we are from our maximal discount.
Jody, go ahead with the second part.
Yeah, can you say that because of this lack of testing that you've described this morning, that we are farther behind in reopening than we would have been had this testing been provided?
I can't quantify it, but I can tell you that among the people who may have been infected and started a whole outbreak who were not identified because they didn't have access to testing, it's likely quite significant. I cannot quantify it for you. But remember, testing, this is our eyes. This is what enables us to see what's going on. Without that testing, we can't see. And we've got to be able to see in order to know how to get this under control. And it's an all hands on deck proposition.
And Jody, let me just add that the impact of not having all of our partners testing is that the county had to broadly expand our ability to do testing. And all of the resources we're using there are other resources we could be using to fight COVID-19. We have a finite pie. So really what we're asking is the private sector to do their part so that the public sector can continue to do our part. Do you want to try Kat again, Alan?
Yes, Kat, I'll be sending you an unmute now. Please accept the unmute to present your question. Kat, I see that you're unmuted.
A little bit, Kat, if you could just speak up a little bit louder.
Yeah, sorry, is that better?
Better.
Okay.
They need to do their part so we can do our.
Does this revised order require the healthcare providers to test, for example, an asymptomatic person who may have had contact with someone with COVID but aren't sure if that person was a confirmed positive?
Dr. Cody?
I could start and then James can chime in. I just want to review if someone says they have had contact with someone who's a confirmed case, they need to be tested. They don't have to provide documentation or proof to the healthcare provider. The healthcare provider is required to take the patient at their word. that they were exposed to COVID. That's one category. Another category that's related is, two categories are related. One is if our public health department refers someone to their provider to get tested because for whatever reason we have a concern of an exposure that they need to be retested, the provider is required to test. And also related, anyone who falls into the essential worker category as defined under state law also is entitled to a test. And that's because they just have a greater risk of having been exposed. The more you're out mixing and mingling with other households because of the work that you do, the higher the chance that you're going to be exposed, and you need to get tested to make sure that you're not infected. So those are the groups in addition to the folks that are symptomatic. James, do you want to add anything to that?
I think, Dr. Cody, I think you covered the major categories. I do want to note that the order differentiates a little bit between the first couple categories, people who are symptomatic, people who have been exposed, or people who have been directed to testing, and then those who, asymptomatic essential workers who fall outside of those categories. And for those essential workers, again, that's the broad definition pulled directly from the state regulations and encompasses so many, in fact, all of our frontline workers, public and private, who are out there doing critical work, but are at risk of exposure as a result. It's important for them to get regularly tested in surveillance testing. And so that's encompassed in the order as well.
And if I might sneak in another related question, are you requiring these healthcare providers now to provide a test within a certain time period, say same day or within 24 hours, or to report the results within a certain time period, say like 24 or 48 hours?
James?
Yeah, so the order requires that results, first of all, there's two timing requirements in the order that are important. The first is we've heard so many concerns about people being able to get their test taken. And so the order requires that for persons who are symptomatic, for persons who have been exposed, and for persons who have been referred to testing by the public health department, that they be tested immediately if they present in person, or no later than the next business day if they're calling or emailing or otherwise messaging for getting scheduled. And those are maximum timeframes. For essential workers who are not symptomatic, who are just doing regularly scheduled testing, they have to be provided with testing within 3 days. Then on the second piece of the timing, or the results piece, the order establishes a requirement that results be provided within 3 days. Obviously, even sooner would be better, but that's a requirement. And if a large healthcare system cannot meet that 3-day requirement, they have to affirmatively provide notice to the county and submit a corrective action plan explaining what steps they are taking to reduce that turnaround time. So this is to address both sides of the timing concerns that so many people have experienced. And as we know, if it takes too long to get tested or it takes too long to get the results, it really, really hampers the efficacy, the ability to break those chains of transmission through contact tracing, through effective isolation and quarantine.
Thank you. I'm gonna, we have a few questions in the chat. I'm gonna take those real quick. What role will the county testing sites and private healthcare providers play in routine testing of teachers and school staff as school starts begin to reopen in Santa Clara County? And Dr. Cody or James, do either of you want to take that?
I can take a start. We have in our school guidance a recommendation that school staff, teachers and other staff do get regular testing. And we recommend teachers, most of them have a healthcare provider in the county, and we recommend that they go to their healthcare provider for that testing. That's our top level recommendation. The county serves as a backstop. So if for some reason someone's not able to get testing, they of course may come to one of our county testing sites. They're available to all.
Thank you. And then Joyce Cutter from Bloomberg Law, what have been Kaiser, Sutter, and HCA's responses to the county's ordinance thus far? And why has the county resorted to fines in this news conference? And I'll turn that one over to James.
So we have had, of course, a number of conversations with large healthcare systems, including Kaiser, including Sutter, PAMF, including HCA and others. You know, the response has been varied, but has often focused on the very real challenges associated with setting up robust testing infrastructure and supply chains and so forth. We know about those challenges because, of course, the county is conducting a tremendous amount of testing. As Supervisor Simidian, I think, referenced, you know, they're certainly real, but they're absolutely surmountable. They are absolutely challenges that can be met and have been met. And that's one of the reasons we're so confident in the current order and in making these enhancements to the order, because we know, since the county is already delivering, that that you know these are absolutely achievable objectives. So the response is mostly focused on concerns about being able to effectuate widespread testing, but we know it can be done, it is being done, and we need everyone to step up and do it.
Thank you. I'm gonna now go back to Alex.
Thank you, Supervisor. Next, we have Mauricio Laplante from San Jose Spotlight. Mauricio, I'll be sending you an unmute now. Please accept the unmute to present your question.
Hi, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, yes. This is just kind of like along the timeline. Just how long do you foresee hospitals needing to, you know, increase their testing? You know, will this order last into like December, January, you know, in light of there being a possible second wave? And, you know, how much will hospitals need to like increase their testing for that?
Dr. Cody?
Yes. We don't know how long we'll need to have this order in place. The order is in place indefinitely. I think it depends a lot on the trajectory of the pandemic, and that in turn depends on us. So the more that we can identify people who are infectious and need to isolate, and the more that we can protect their contacts, the faster we'll be able to get out of it. But again, the foundation is really our ability to see, which is testing. So the order is in place until rescinded, and the timeline is unknown.
Thank you.
Thank you, Alex.
Thank you. Now we have Len Ramirez again from KPIX. Len, I'll be sending you an unmute. Please accept the unmute to present your question.
Hi, actually, James answered my question. My question had to do with, you know, some of the explanations that the providers are giving for not doing. I'm just wondering, maybe as a follow-up, if you know, there's a cost involved, if these things are very expensive, supply chain, stuff like that.
Sure, you know, undoubtedly there are costs involved with setting up testing, but there's a couple important things to note. One is that through the actions of the state and federal governments in regulating insurers, there is mandatory coverage of COVID testing. That is a reimbursement mechanism that's available to providers. And of course, if you're a provider like Kaiser, who is also the insurer, that should be an even more streamlined and kind of closed system process. The second is, you have to look at the costs in aggregate. If we can't test, isolate, quarantine folks up front, and the chains of transmission extend, for example, through a whole family, the cost of healthcare that has to be delivered goes up as well. And third, For many of these providers, I know they have been very eager, and in fact, many of them have prioritized testing for elective procedures and other procedures that bring patients into their systems and that are important to them from a revenue standpoint. This order makes clear that while absolutely testing should be widespread and go well beyond the priority categories in the order, including all of those folks, those tests cannot be prioritized over these categories. And so those have to be in addition to this testing and not a substitution for this testing. And so all those things together, I think, just underscore how critical it is, but by no means should any financial issue be an impediment.
Thank you. Thanks, Len. Our last question is going to go to Chris Nguyen, as we're just around a little, going a little after 12, and I want to be respectful of all of my colleagues' time and all of your time. Chris, you get the last word. Alex?
Chris, I've sent you the unmute. Please accept it to present your question.
You're still on mute, Chris. Ah, there you go. Oh, you're back on mute.
Hi there, sorry about that. The computer froze as it was tossing over to me. So thank you so much, President Chavez. I apologize if I missed this. I know David Campos ran through some of the actual numbers, but really quickly, could you point us to where that press release with the numbers are? Also, overall, what's the current percentage of tests being performed by the county health system right now? And secondly, what role do the insurance companies play in all of this? Because I think there's some confusion among people about that as well.
Thank you. I'm gonna let, James, can I let you take this question on the, and also Chris, we'll get you that press release. Go ahead, James.
Sure, so regarding the, the first question was about the percentage. I don't have an exact percentage, but if you look on our data dashboard, which is on the website, and you go to the healthcare system testing dashboard, you'll see a chart, and you can figure out the percentage from there. But it's not even close. The graph alone shows very plainly, exactly how disproportionate the testing being conducted by the county health system is relative to the other systems, even though the county health system is not the largest system in the county by patients served. So that gives you just a flavor of the order of magnitude. We're talking about really many multiples of disproportionality in having people do their appropriate share of testing. Issues around I'm sorry, I'm forgetting the other two parts of your question. Slipped my mind.
Chris, do you want to restate what we didn't answer?
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Hi, James. What role do the insurance companies play in all of this? Because there's some confusion about that with some folks.
Absolutely. And sorry, I just kind of slipped my mind. But the insurers are absolutely critical, and they are subject to specific regulations. So the state has put out regulations mandating that insurers provide coverage for these same categories of individuals. And that's why in this revised order, we've actually just completely aligned the essential worker definition with the state DMHC regulations so that there's a complete one-to-one match. So these are the exact same folks that the state is requiring that insurers provide testing coverage to. In addition, the federal government in Congress took steps to require that that testing be provided without co-pays and without other financial cost to individual patients. So again, it dovetails with that as well. But we do need the insurers to provide the coverage that they're obligated to provide in order for there to be funding to help cover the cost of testing. That being said, this is an obligation on the healthcare systems, and it's part and parcel of providing the mandatory minimum standard of care in our community. And there are so many other areas that we take for granted where there are regulatory or other requirements on healthcare providers to take certain steps in the provision of care to their patients. This is one of those. This is one of those that's specifically designed to deal with the COVID-19 emergency in this particular context, but it's not unique for there to be public health requirements from the state level and from the local level on providers to say, these are minimum things that need to be done.
James, one last question, and that's this order takes effect when?
So the current testing order is obviously already in effect. These enhancements, and so that's already binding, and those are already current obligations. The enhancements, the changes that we've talked about, go into effect next Friday, September 25th. And so that allows a little lead time for these providers to take all the steps necessary to do the noticing, to put in place the right systems, to make that alignment. But the baseline order is already in effect today.
Thank you. With that, I wanted to just say a very significant thank you to the staff and to all of my colleagues countywide who joined us today. I think the mayors not only put, the mayors really put a lot of pressure on the county to perform, and now they're putting pressure on the private sector to perform. And I think that's right, because the bottom line is that we want to get children back to school. We want to get workers back to work. And we need the private sector to do their job so that the county and the public sector can do our job. This is really a partnership that we'd like to have, because we know that we're still in the middle of fighting COVID-19. Again, I wanna thank everybody very much for participating. And if there's any assistance folks still need or questions they want answered, they can feel free to call our offices and or the county PIO. So thank you, everybody. Thank you for joining us. And thank you, Dr. Cody and James and all of our mayors and Supervisor Simidian. Have a good day, everybody.
Thank you.